Hello, welcome back to How Shostakovich Wrote His String Quartet Number 8. Today we're talking about the third movement. Before we start, I'll mention again that these videos take a ton of time and effort, so if you enjoy this sort of stuff or anything else on the channel, please do consider subscribing. It's very much appreciated. All right, let's get into the third movement. Okay, so the inclusion of a middle dance movement is bizarrely in line with string quartet tradition, blending conventional form with the other bizarre traits of various 20th century musical practices is one of the things that Shostakovich does really well. Now, having this waltz movement may seem like he's kind of throwing a wrench in the works, especially since everything's been so, you know, unpredictable and ambiguous, especially the second movement. And dance music tends to be, you know, really predictable and really straightforward. It's actually a really good move on his part, in my opinion, to add something that we can get a more clear sense of compared to the previous two movements. Had he kept on with the much more dissonant aesthetic, we would have wound up with something like the 13th or 15th quartets, which are both excellent pieces in their own ways, but they have a very different sense about them that can be more challenging for folks to relate to, especially the 13th. And again, this isn't a bad thing, it's just different. So here Shostakovich is trying to remind us of the tragically human nature of the subject matter of the piece. He also has no problem blending this waltz in with his already established music. It's unique enough to stand out, but it fits in beautifully, and it's its own pillar of a movement that helps to hold up the whole quartet. So conceptually, it may seem a strange choice, but Shostakovich's ability to sit in an aesthetic serves him and this quartet really well, so it works out just fine. It's also important to note that while this may be the most predictable movement of the five, it does have its own jaggedness to it, and sections where the key is completely unclear, so we'll talk about all of those things. On the macro scale, the general form of this is ternary, so A, B, A prime-ish, and there are these short little transitional sections into and out of the movement. The A sections are characterized by this theme that is developed out of the DSCH motif, this one right here that sort of continues on there, which is really cool because it gets harmonically recontextualized a lot, especially, you know, compared to the first movement. And so I'll show you what I mean by that. The transposition here is the same as the original motif. It's the literal DSCH, but the movement here is pretty insistent on G minor. So instead of this being re, me, do, ti, it's actually more like so, le, fa, mi. We'll talk about this more in a second, but it's just an interesting recontextualization because it is insistent on its original transposition, but now against a new harmony. Now, there are a few other melodic ideas in the A section, but the main stuff really stems out of this DSCH as per usual. Now in the B section, we've got all sorts of chaos that sort of bridges the gap between our creepy little waltz thing and stuff that sounds a little more like what we've come to expect from music such as that of the second movement. Now there's this really strange march-like section in 2-2 that mixes up the meter a bit, so it creates that uneasy lopsidedness in some of these melodic motions. It then goes on to quote the first cello concerto right here before it leads us into one of the most characteristic parts of the B section, which is all of this really windy chromatic stuff with the cello solo here. And then it brings us back into the A section, which has been somewhat altered and chopped up before leading us out into the fourth movement. So let's go back to the beginning in a little bit more detail. So starting with the transition section that brings us into the movement proper, we've got one really bold statement of the DSCH from the first violin. And so a few things to note here. The first note is divided into two eighth notes, and it's also placed on a weak beat. And both of those are things that help propel the movement, and they're traits that the motif will keep throughout much of the main melodic material for the movement. And then there's this swell on the very last note of the motif that the second violin has joined in on. And this is a really cool effect because the second violin is trilling this half step and the first violin is not. So you get this really strange sound where you can hear sustained pitch, but it's also clearly being disrupted. And it can sometimes sound like this really distorted vibrato. This is another thing that gets used throughout the movement, so this whole thing serves as a really nice introduction to the music that we're going to hear. Now we've got this sort of cadenza that starts here, given by the first violin. It's this really interesting blend of chromatic figures and really consonant intervals as well. Like if we look at the first two bars of it, we can see that there are these descending chromatic eighth notes, but then there's just this D flat minor triad, just give it in quarter notes. And it sort of does the same thing as it continues. The second time it's followed by perfect fourth leaps. And then we get this really interesting figure right here that is repeated a few times, but it varies on its anchor notes. So the second and third beats of each of these repetitions are just literal repetitions, but the first beats are chromatically ascending here. So you can see that we've got an A flat and then an A natural and then a B flat. It's kind of like some of the stuff we saw on movement two, where the voice leading is done on anchor notes and not necessarily completely horizontally, if that makes sense. And then we've got these really stately quarter notes here that kind of wrap up the line before one more of those figures actually from up here. It's now slightly altered and in a much lower register. And then the cello gives us a lovely 5-1 in the key of G minor. And we're also, our key signature is marked in G minor. So it's very strongly feeling that tonal area. So let's go ahead and listen to that real quick. Okay, so there are four bars of this G minor waltz pattern given by the cello on beat one, and then the viola, who provides beats two and three and adds the third and the fifth to the chord. This is a really nice figuration because with the five in the lower voice of the viola and the three in the upper voice, it makes a minor sixth between the two fingers there. And that's one of the most comfortable double stops you can do on string instruments. So that's just a really nice thing. It has this suddenness to it, this whole thing right here, because it's, you know, marked at forte, and it's also the first instance of that really meaty low register in the whole movement, but it very quickly dies away within those first four bars with these diminuendos. There's also no recent low register in the second movement to speak of, so it's just a very striking thing. The first violin then gives us the main melodic material of the A sections and the movement as a whole. So our first DSCH of the movement, with its beginning on beat two, notice that, and its repeated first note, that gets combined with the rhythmic identity of those repeated figures in the cadenza-like bit, so this stuff up here. Those two things are combined to give us this main melody. And then it's essentially just that same statement repeated four times before the violin breaks off into this descending chromatic quarter note line. And then the second violin joins in again on this really cool trill effect, but this time it's dovetailed from the first violin, so that it matches the last note of the DSCH, and so it feels like the melody literally splits into two, which is a really cool effect. And meanwhile, the cello and viola are back to their basic waltz accompaniment here, and Shostakovich is once again taking advantage of the half step as a very important interval to the music, because once the violins break off into two different lines there, you can see that the cello raises its note half step, as well as the top note of the viola. And these things happen to line up to effectively create an A-flat diminished chord, so he's going between G minor and A-flat diminished, but it's helped by how he's voicing things and only moving by half step, and all of those sort of work together to help the creepy atmosphere of it all. And then before the melody repeats itself, it actually has a very slight pause. This happened before, I didn't mention it, up here. Now the pause is an important part of the jaggedness of this waltz. It's on those two beats that I pointed out. And the pause is just long enough to disrupt the natural flow of the music, but it's also kind of a nice punctuation. It's really uneven, but it works well. So then we get the exact same thing repeated pretty much verbatim, those eight-ish bars. Now it is being repeated verbatim, but that's not really a detrimental thing here. The music is moving quickly enough that that's not really a negative. Now those eight bars are followed up by a section that's a little bit more reminiscent of the introductory material. We can see it given in these first two bars at rehearsal 37 here. And then sort of the same idea being transposed down. And then back to that main rhythmic idea of four eighth notes being followed by a quarter note, which gets repeated once more before the second violin just cuts like a dagger through the whole thing on this really high E flat down to D natural minor ninth leap, which is really cool. Now the second violin is an obvious thing, but there are other things that are disrupting the flow of music as well. It's really interesting that for the two bars leading up to that moment, the main accompaniment pattern stops and both the viola and cello are only playing on beat two. So you can see here the pattern changes. And so it just displaces the meter a little bit, even if the meter itself isn't actually changing. And then in the first violin, we have this three note ascending figure, once again, repeated down a half step. And then inverted, B flat, A flat, G, which brings us out of that slightly newer material and then back into the main theme. Another thing that changes in 37 is the frequency of harmonic shifting. So instead of a change on every four bars, we're now fluctuating between those two chords every other bar. And that's just sort of a signal that we're gonna arrive at the peak of the melody, you know, on sort of the macro scale, before it gets repeated or further developed. And on these aforementioned beat twos of the accompaniment, the voices that have been changing get raised by another half step, but the D stays anchored. That's kind of a common thing here, is this D in the bottom finger of the viola, that's always sort of staying the same. Perhaps he's trying to keep the five of the main key of G minor in the loop of everything, but that might be a little bit of a stretch. And the accompaniment continues to move chromatically, so they sort of stay the same here on this A and D, and then they go down by a half step, and then we go back into that first idea that brought us into the waltz, which was the really prominent 5-1, followed by the viola giving us beats 2 and 3, as well as the rest of the chord. Okay, and then at rehearsal 38 here, all of this gets repeated all the way up to rehearsal 39. All of that is repeated from what we just heard. It may seem like a lot of repetition, but I think that that's very appropriate for a dance movement. And again, it's moving fast enough that it's not detracting from the pacing of the music. So that's a huge stretch of the A section there. But before we listen to it, I want to touch on something that has to do with what actually makes the music itself creepy. Now, one really prominent thing has to do with its harmonic identity. So there are all these factors, as I've stated, that very heavily imply G minor. But there's something funny about the DSCH being in its original transposition and being juxtaposed against that. That's like the main motif of the melody. Because the DSCH is very much at odds with G minor, especially with it being rhythmically shifted so that its last note, the B natural, lands on beat one so that it coincides with the G and gives us that major third. Now, obviously, B natural is a pretty clear foil to G minor, but it's used in addition to, not instead of, B flat. So we're not oscillating between G minor and G major, nor are we in an octatonic mode. The other notes in the DSCH motif sort of keep that out of the question. Using them simultaneously creates this really eerie feeling that just pervades the whole movement, and in conjunction with the fact that it's a waltz, makes it so that it has this sort of like unnatural drunkenness to it. Now, another thing that contributes to the music's creepiness is how high and short all of the melody notes are. For the most part, in terms of range, the melody and the accompaniment are really far away from each other, and there's this big empty hole in the middle of the range of the string quartet. And it's not like he can't fill that space because everyone's occupied. I mean, the second violin is literally doing nothing for the majority of this music. Now, speaking of the second violin, its contributions to the texture are also what sell this aesthetic. We already talked about the B natural, but when that gets dovetailed into the second violin, like on these trills here, it really establishes B natural as an unquestionably important note. Anyway, I just wanted to mention those things because they're an important part of how the movement feels. So with those things in mind, let's take a listen to it. Okay, so rehearsal 39 introduces us to some new melodic ideas, the most prominent of those being this one that's largely dominated by half steps, but also perfect fifths. So you can see how this stretch of, you know, four-ish bars here really takes advantage of the open strings of the violin. And it's not necessary to use the open strings here, but it's an interesting choice to start the motif on an open G and then move it up a fifth each time. And to just sort of go into what I mean there, this little cell right here is what's being transposed up a fifth every single time, just to make that a little bit more clear. Now, this motif also repeats in an accompanimental form in the viola, so you can see that right here. However, it never gets transposed, and it also starts on beat two rather than beat three. And the cello, meanwhile, is on this repeated figure, which seems to very much imply that we're in a C minor-ish tonal area, which is harmonically adjacent to G minor, so it's not as dramatic as some of the other harmonic shifts that Shostakovich has done in this piece. He's saving the more jarring changes for later in the movement when we move across those larger scale borders, but for now we're still in the A section. Now, he also keeps up the heavy use of the major third in a minor key, with there's a lot of pretty heavy emphasis on E natural on all of these little statements here. You know, there's this really snarling triplet material, which is punctuated by the second violin pizzicato, which is kind of a cool little effect there. However, interestingly, for the stretch of this music, the cello has shifted its bottom note up, again, a half step, to a D flat. And so it's a bit of a different vibe, but we're still seeing E natural as an important note in a generally C minor area. And the viola is just continuing that same stuff throughout that whole stretch of four bars right there. And so that whole stretch of music from rehearsal 39 up to there then gets repeated right here. But it then goes into this quarter note stuff here that seems to be centered around G minor, while the second violin here actually provides some DSCH statements. And the viola and cello give these stabs right here in C sharp and E. Those stabs actually show us that on every beat one, it's rare that we can look at a full vertical sonority here and make sense of it. but on every beat one here, we're getting a C sharp half diminished seven chord. All of those C sharp half diminished strikes happen before the violin then does these pretty dramatic leaps and brings us back down into C minor. Now at rehearsal 40, we have the bulk of all of that 39 content repeated, but the tail end of it is changed into something that'll coast into the beginning material at rehearsal 41. And so the stretch of new music that isn't repeated starts here at measure 95. So it's all of this up to 41. And it's really harmonically ambiguous. So there are these major seconds and major thirds that are shared between the viola and cello, while the second violin provides beat ones, but the second violin also sustains. Now, the particularly ambiguous measures are 95, 97, and then 99 and 100. But the ones in between seem to shape this E minor chord, which is really strange. I'm gonna uncomplicate this real quick. So there are these faint outlines of E minor, but it's so fleeting that we're not really solidly anywhere, which is fine anyway, because after these quarter notes from the first violin here, we are brought back into our original material. And there is a nice consistency here. The rhythm of the first violin on all of these quarter notes actually does match the parallel section in 39 with this stretch of quarter notes. So there's a little bit of consistency there. Now, one thing that you may have noticed about this section compared to the beginning material that we're about to return to is that it provides a lot of contrast in terms of articulation. You know, if we go back up to the A section, you can see that almost every single note here is marked with staccato, and there's not a single slur to be found, which this music in this part of the A section is very much the opposite. It's good to remember that articulation is a really powerful tool, which is not something that we often talk about very deeply in composition. It's more often just sort of intuited, which is fine, but I thought it was sort of important to bring that up here, and it's something to, you know, sort of keep in the back of your mind when you're writing. So then at 41, we have another statement of our main melody, but after eight bars of, you know, what's essentially a verbatim repetition, the cello and the viola have been brought up an octave and the cello is now sustaining, so it's a little bit different. But after those eight-ish bars, we're brought into this shrieking dissonance here, while the second violin descends on mostly chromatic quarter notes, and the first violin gives these really wild gestures. Now, they have the same rhythmic identity, four eighth notes and then quarter notes in some capacity. So while it's rhythmically consistent, intervallically, it's just all over the place. It follows the second violin's downward trajectory vaguely, but it's got these really, really enormous major seven leaps between the C sharps and the D's right here and right here. So then the viola takes the line from the first violin and brings us on that very same rhythm into the B section. You can see that right here into rehearsal 42. So let's go ahead and listen to all of that. So the B section is a bit shorter than the first A section, and it's much more sporadic. Not very much gets repeated in this section, and in some instances, there's not really any tonality to speak of. So it contrasts the outside sections of the movement quite well, actually. Now, a really obvious contrast is that right when we arrive at rehearsal 42 here, it's not even really a waltz anymore. It's most clearly marked by that 2-2 meter there. The viola goes into this F minor figuration here that goes on until the first violin gives us these two DSCH statements that leap up a minor sixth after each one. So there's a minor sixth from the B to the G, and then a minor sixth from the E to the C. Then we go back into 3-4 briefly for some material that's very reminiscent of the very beginning violin solo. However, it's accompanied by these big cluster strikes from the rest of the group, and it also goes into 2-4 for a second just to sort of tighten things up on the first violin eighth notes. And this is a really great example of how just a few slight meter changes can help keep your music fresh and rhythmically interesting and just sort of keep it in motion. Now, I remember as a beginning composer, I was very much of the opinion that changing meter for the sake of it was a sort of stupid avant-garde thing to do, and that's just because I didn't know anything at all yet. So it goes. So after this little sequence of asymmetry here, we go back into this F minor figure. And the following material all sort of repeats itself. However, we have another instance of Shostakovich repeating his material in the same fashion and then inverting the tail end of it. So if you remember the second movement, this also happened there. Now, first iteration of this section had these descending figures right here in the first violin, and then again right here. And you'll see in the second iteration that these two arpeggios are ascending. You know, it only does it for the first two, but then it makes some really large leaps down before quoting Shostakovich's first cello concerto right here. Now that's a piece that has a similar obsession with a four-note motif, and so that's what gets quoted right there. Now he quotes pretty explicitly for a few bars, even this accompaniment is pretty similar. But he does this really cool thing where he's combining the quote with elements from this movement. For example, in this 3-4 bar here, where the violin has a quarter note and then four eighth notes bringing us upward chromatically, that's something we've seen a number of times in this movement. And that brings us up to another statement of the concerto quote. And now that sort of two-bar mashup thing then repeats itself, however now it's transposed up. And then the second violin joins the first violin for some lovely parallel fifths on these chromatic lines that bring us into the next part of the B section. So let's just go ahead and listen to all that real quick. Rehearsal 44 is largely characterized by the bizarre winding chromaticism of the violins, which accompany this cello solo right here, who has yet to do anything fun in this movement, so that's nice. Now to sort of get the violins out of the way here, they're always locked in a perfect interval away from each other. So before rehearsal 44 up to measure 165, they're always locked in parallel fifths, but then at 165 they switch to parallel fourths up until rehearsal 45, where they go back to fifths. The notes generally stay in that same high register, although they do sometimes veer pretty high, like this bit as we get near 180 here. Like all this stuff is pretty high, but timbrally it's pretty much the same thing. So the violins establish nothing in terms of tonality, but the cello solo actually does, and it's pretty neat. The cello seems to imply a C minor-ish type of tonal area, but it's consistent with the movement in that there are a number of notes that don't belong to C minor that are established as important, particularly the major three, E natural. And we can see that sort of near the tail end of the solo, like right here again, and again, and it's actually the note that ends the solo and sustains after the solo. It's also really interesting how throughout the melody, B natural is really, really emphasized. Every other bar has B natural on at least beat one, if not the whole bar. And it's a really cool way to create tension by building a melody that's based on the T of the key, if that sort of makes sense. So you could potentially refer to this as Locrian, but you'd still need to include the ish in your assessment of the tonality because, again, it's not really explicit. Now, however you may think of it, it never stays in one place for too long, but it centers very much around the same types of notes that we've seen in the movement so far. It's also really interesting how the melody is expanded in terms of its rhythmic vocabulary compared to the other melodies in this movement. So most of them so far have been centered around quarters and eighths, really tight-knit rhythms, whereas this is much more, you know, halves and quarters and dotted halves. It's much more expanded. There's not a single eighth note to be seen in this whole melody. And so, as previously stated, the melody ends when it gets to this all-important E natural here, and it holds as the chromatic lines sort of fade out. It comes to rest right here before giving one more little half note statement before, you know, leaving for good and then bringing us into rehearsal 46 here. So let's listen to that whole section up to there. And so now we're back in the A section, and it doesn't actually start where the main melody starts, as you might imagine, but it actually gives us all of that cadenza-type material, but it's now in the viola, and there are a few other important differences in the repeated material as well. So you can see the cadenza is now in the viola, and also everyone but the cello is muted, so that's a big difference. Eventually the cello does mute when it's given the opportunity to do so. Yeah, right here before rehearsal 48 that happens. But until then it's just holding this high E, so it doesn't really have the opportunity to do so. And check out my video on mutes if you want. Now, speaking of that E, that's another really important difference. The cello, who used to be giving us the beat one of every bar, is now just holding on to this E through so much of this material. E natural, by the way, has nothing to do with the key of G minor, so that's exciting. So it's just this really creepy and ominous tone that's just sitting on top of all of this more familiar stuff. And it also forces a change in function. So Shostakovich decided that someone needed to be giving those beat ones, so he simply added it to the viola. You can see here that instead of just beats two and three, which he still does have in the viola is also giving beat one. Now he's also upped the viola material by an octave so that beat one could be still given in a lower register than beats two and three. Now, another big change is that he trims a lot of the fat on this section, so he only gives us a single iteration of the main melody here before going into the C minor-ish section. So here's the main melody, and he only gives it once, and then all of a sudden we're now in that C minor-ish half-step oriented material. And then the same thing happens to the C minor section. We only hear it once, and then we move on. So we've got what was originally the second statement of this material, but in this sort of A prime section, it's the first iteration. And so that original second iteration included returning to this main melody and then going into this crazy dissonant part. Here's a great example of fortissimo muted string instruments. It's really cool. And then we actually get an abridged version of the B section here. So we have the shrieking bit, we have the viola doing the F minor figure, all the same stuff here. The cello concerto quote happens, but then the first violin then goes into these half notes here at rehearsal 52. I know I'm sort of flying through all this stuff, but it's all just repeated material, so I'm not gonna, you know, get too in-depth here. I don't know if this is intentional, but there is a DSE ray right here. It could be intentional and meaningful, but I have a bit of a habit of spotting DSE rays where they're just completely coincidental, so take that with a grain of salt. Given the content of the fourth movement, this sustained A sharp right here is the perfect way to bring us into that. Let's go ahead and listen to this whole A prime section. ¶¶ All right, so I hope that this helped you get a better understanding of the third movement of this quartet. Please be sure to like the video and subscribe to the channel if you're into this sort of stuff. It, again, is very much appreciated. And I'll see you next time for the fourth movement.